Hello, welcome to another series of which I am planning on calling Understanding AI. And in this episode, we're going to be answering the question, what is GPT in ChatGPT? Maybe you know already, but I thought it was an interesting term to explore. So before we dive in, I'm just going to explain a little bit of background to this series. Any regular viewers of the channel know about a couple of weeks ago, I had a run of shorts while I took a bit of a break and thought about different things I could do. There's other projects in the pipeline, but one thing came up was that I wanted to revisit artificial intelligence in some way. I'll try and very quickly explain my own relationship, if you like, with AI over the years. So sometime in the early to mid 80s, I got heavily involved in numerical taxonomy when applied to bacterial identification. And during that period, I was primarily using matrices in combination with statistical and probabilistic calculations. So very much the work of Sneath and I think it's Wilcox to basically analyze test results from bacterial identification systems against a matrix. And how I got involved with that is the firm that I was working with, predominantly they were doing that on deck mini computers at the time. And the R&D manager was looking at ways of porting it across to the early IBM PCs and the clones that were around in the mid 80s. And so because I was I was a single person department, I think my technical title was quality support project leader, something like that. And what I was tasked with doing was, it was sort of a blank check job where as a reward for computerizing the quality control department, I got to pick any project I wanted in IT in terms of computerizing systems and just run with it. It was great. I did it for a couple of years. I won't go into details beyond that. Something I probably could have still been doing today had a series of unfortunate events, not to me, but to someone else in the firm, where I had to sort of step up and take over in another role for a period of time. So yeah, it's unfortunate, but that's the way life goes. I was working on special projects, for want of a better word, and that was one thing that came up. This R&D manager wanted me to produce prototypes for PCs, which were versions of software we already had running on deck mini computers. So through that, and just thinking of other ways of doing things, I got exposed to the early neural networks. So this would have been, by then it would have been in the early 90s, 1990. And I have the book here, actually, Foundations of Neural Networks by Taran Khanna. And I think at that point, mainly most neural networks were hardware based, or the main part of it was on its own piece of hardware outside of the computer. Didn't really pursue it that much, but I did start to read around that. There wasn't a lot of appetite really for going down a different avenue when we had perfectly good systems doing modern bacterial taxonomy anyway, albeit just using regular statistics and probability. So didn't really get to explore that much. Then in the mid 90s, when I was working in a different place and I was doing my postgrad in computing and manufacturing, I took a course in intelligent systems analysis and design, where I learnt about frameworks for developing intelligent systems, which was, one of many words that was being used interchangeably with AI. There was a whole slew of words that were under the AI banner, decision support systems, etc. I'm trying to think of the other ones, knowledge-based systems. I also got a bit involved in decision support systems previously because we were also, as part of my remit for developing software when I was in the previous job I'd just spoken about, I had to design some stuff to help marketing decide when we could or couldn't make a particular product based on what the customer was requesting. And it was basically there to avoid marketing making embarrassing production critical mistakes later on down the chain. So yeah, that was something else I got involved with. Later on, I became interested in data science and did a number of courses in data science and analytics. And then in the 2000s, well, actually 2010s, I dabbled a little bit in chatbots, but nothing super serious. Just a firm I was working at wanted to just play around a bit with some feasibility of doing very, very rudimentary chat bots, nothing like ChatGPT. So that's where I've sort of come in from very, very quickly. And so, yeah, I've been fancying getting back on the AI pony for quite a while now, and I think this is a good opportunity to dip my whole body in. So we're going to start off with this question for this first episode. Also, I'm going to set a timer starting now, and you'll see the format of this. I'm going to set a 20-minute timer so that going forward, all episodes are going to be around 20 minutes. They won't have this slightly long preamble. So what is GPT in ChatGPT? It's a bit of a tongue twister. So GPT stands for Generative Pre-trained Transformer. And going forward in these episodes, what I would like people to do is think about the things I've spoken about and in the comments suggestion, suggest which particular direction you'd like me to take things for the next episode. Obviously, I've got some of my own ideas after going through this, because the other thing is that I'm going to do all of these live research. I might do a quick cursory look through, spend about 15 minutes before the episode just orientating myself a little bit so I don't do anything silly and go off down too many dead ends. So yeah, in each episode I'm going to go through live, and at the end of it, what we'll do is I will, in the description, I'll post some links. They won't just be to Wikipedia articles, but they'll hopefully be to primary resources. So yeah, please comment and please suggest where you would like me to go. It would be nice if each episode sort of follows on from the previous one thematically, but you know, the only overarching thing is, I suppose, we stay within artificial intelligence. So as it says here, let's see what the Wikipedia definition is. So generative pre-trained transformers, GPT, are a family of language models generally trained on a large corpus of text data to generate human-like text. They are built using several blocks of the transformer architecture. They can be fine-tuned for various natural language processing tasks, such as text generation. And this is obviously a big feature in ChatGPT, if you've seen it in action at all. Language translation and text classification. The pre-training in its name refers to the initial training process on a large text corpus where the model learns to predict the next word in a passage. And that's super important with this, which provides a solid foundation for the model to perform well on downstream tasks with limited amounts of task-specific data. And over here, we have the original GPT model. So I'm just going to bring that up. I'm not going to go into too much detail in this, but just so you can see clearer what's going on here. So you've got the input, you've got the output, and there's these transformer blocks. And you can see here there's multiple layers in here. So it's layered up. And layering within things like neural networks as well is something you become familiar with if you explore the whole general area of neural networks. And you know, the amount of layers in a network as well, and how that affects the results. There's just three uses listed in the article, one of which is ChatGPT. If we go a bit further down, we have here, this is interesting. The history is pretty short in here. So on June 11th, 2018, OpenAI. So OpenAI is the organization. I'm unsure of how they're classified now. So they're a for-profit subsidiary of OpenAI Limited Partnership. So the non-profit OpenAI Incorporated and its for-profit partnership. At some point, if you want me to, we'll take a look at the whole structure of the firm, if that's something you're interested in. But in this episode, I'll stay clear of that. So there's this paper, and let me just see if I can easily bring this up. So, yep, I'll include a link to that. Looks like that's worth a read. So that came out in 2018. Now, I believe OpenAI was announced to the world in 2015. That's my understanding of that. So that's the paper where they introduced the generative pre-trained transformer. So at that point, the best performing neural NLP models primarily employed supervised learning from large amounts of manually labeled data. This reliance on supervised learning limited their use on datasets that were not well annotated. In addition to making it prohibitively expensive and time consuming to train extremely large models. Now, I have played around with various forms of supervised learning. I did a course, part of a series of courses online through, I think it was Coursera, that were run by Microsoft, and we went through a lot of the different types of supervised learning. Yeah, it's also got here, many languages are difficult to translate and interpret using such models due to lack of available text for corpus building. We'll come back to this word corpus in a moment. In contrast, GPT's semi-supervised approach involved two stages. So this is really critical. So we've got an unsupervised generative pre-training stage in which a language modeling objective was used to set initial parameters, and then a supervised discriminative fine-tuning stage in which these parameters were adapted to a target task. Now, you'll see here they mention the sort of corpus of data. So this is what they're pulling, you know, into the system. This is what they are basing their, so here employed supervised learning from large amounts. So the large amounts of data are these corpuses. So we can see here we've got this book corpus, so a data set consisting of text of around 11,000 unpublished books scraped from the internet. So as we go through the different iterations of GPT, you can see each one is built on the previous, but there's certain modifications, and they're changing the corpus. And you can see this one we've got Reddit, this one we've got Wikipedia. So that's the first pass through this article. So I want to break this down. So what is actually generative? What is pre-trained and what is transformer? So I'm going to look at generative first for a couple of reasons. Obviously, it's first on the list, but I did notice when I did a quick pass through, a name popped up. So with a generative model, in statistical classification, two main approaches are called the generative approach and the discriminative approach. Now, I did notice that there's two distinguishing classes mentioned in this paper, but three mentioned in a paper by Gebra. So there's not overall agreement about in statistical classification, like how to divide the approaches down. But when you're talking about the generative model, it's a statistical model of the joint probability distribution on a given observable variable X and a target variable Y. So we've got this. So a generative model is a form of statistical model in here. And I'm going to include the link here. But what I was more interested in when they start talking about generative models is when you get down the bottom and they're talking about text generation, which is what really I'm concerned about most here, is the reference to Shannon. So, and I'm aware of this book. I actually have a copy of it. You can also read it online, and I'll include a link. The Mathematical Theory of Communication. It's a pretty key book in all sorts of areas of communication as it pertains to, you know, the computer sciences and that whole area of information sciences. So if you've done any work in information sciences at all, then invariably you'll come across this. But I'm going to just put that up here. Oh, actually, that's right. I had problems finding this. So I'll find it separately. It's just reminding me you can't find it. The link's broken. So I'll search for this independently after the session, and I'll include a link to that. Now, the reason why I think it's important in this discussion, because it's an important source in lots of other areas, is this. In it, it gives an example in which a table of frequencies of English word pairs is used to generate a sentence beginning with representing and speedily is an good, which is not proper English, but will increasingly approximate it as the table is moved from word pairs to word triplets. So clearly Shannon was looking at word pairs and the generating of sentences, and I'm curious as to how much of this got absorbed into this generative model on there. So that's the article for the generative part of GPT, and I'll include additional links to, just to make it easy on you, to these articles here if you're interested in exploring it further. So the pre-trained, which we saw mentioned here, so this pre-training stage is the stage where the language modeling objective is used to set initial parameters. So this is the key thing of this whole GPT, is this pre-training stage, and then this second. So the pre-training stage is unsupervised, and the second stage is supervised. So just so you're clear, supervised learning is a machine learning paradigm for problems where the available data consists of labeled examples, meaning that each data point contains features and an associated label. So if you've got a set of inputs, if you like, you know, you also have a corresponding output. So you might have, say, let me think of an example here with data. So you might have, using an example from numerical taxonomy, from bacterial identification, you might have a series of test results from a test kit, and you might know that when the tests perform in a certain way, it identifies that test, that bacteria you're testing, as a certain bacteria. And so you know, when you have these results from your test, it identifies as this particular bacteria. So there's a label there, it's supervised learning. So what you end up doing is you feed in all these examples, these test examples, along with the bacterial identification, and then you can sort of train whatever system you're using. So when you put an unknown in, it looks to see whether it matches by whatever mathematical model or whatever function or whatever neural network you're using, whatever method you choose to use, just talking generally. And it will then predict the output. So the key thing with supervised learning is you're already providing it with labeled data. In unsupervised learning, you're not labeling the data. So things like clustering could be an example of unsupervised learning. So you're feeding all the data in and you're seeing what clusters form. And that formation, if you like, that clustering, in one example, it might be, used to do a slightly different thing in this particular instance, but, the grouping of data, if you like, is then used to set initial parameters. Now, I'm trying to think of an example where I've seen that used in a test I did. I did see it one time. So where I saw unsupervised learning used and I had to use it was a case study we did on analyzing the data from GPS positions on mobile phones. And through looking at the clustering and the time of day, you were able to determine whether the person was at work or whether they were traveling without having specific labels associated to that. So the data in the data itself, you didn't know, based on the GPS location of the phone, if the person was in a particular where they were was work, was travel, was shopping, was home. But through analyzing multiple examples of the data and clustering it on a map, you could see where those clusters occurred and what time of day, because you had the timestamp, and then sort of work out, oh, that person was at work, or they were commuting, or they were at home. And so, there's lots of examples like that of where unsupervised learning might be used. In this example, it's being used to set initial parameters in the, in the neural NLP model, whatever they're using here. And hopefully, as we explore this and as we look at papers and as people ask questions in the comments section, I'll dig deeper into terms of, what actually might they be using in, this particular generative pre-trained transformer. So we'll see. And then the word transformer is a deep learning model that adopts the mechanism of self-attention, differentially weighting the significance of each part of the input data, and is used primarily in the fields of natural language processing. So when you're doing deep learning or any form of neural network, and it's something we can get into in a later episode, there's this weighting that goes on as the data is being pumped in. The network, the nodes on the network are being weighted for each part of the input data. And so that's where the transformer architecture comes in. And itself, it's doing that itself. It's weighting based on, it's, you know, performing this weighting based on the input data. So we have this, in this term, there's a generative component going on, which is the actual model, if you like, the statistical model that it's using, which is based on probability. We've got this idea that it's being pre-trained, that it's just being used to set this like initial set of parameters before it starts using supervised for discriminative fine-tuning. And then we've got this transformer component or transformer architecture, which refers to this, you know, sort of self-adjusting weighting that's going on. Not waiting as in waiting for a bus, but waiting as in biasing, I suppose you could say, various aspects of the neural network. And I can tell by going through this, I'm definitely going to have to talk about things like perceptrons in a later episode. So like always with a lot of this stuff is I end up generating more questions than I do answers in this. But hopefully as a way of getting things off the ground, you've found this useful. I'll include links to all of the things I've spoken about. That's my alarm clock going off. And that's the 20 minutes up now. And yeah, so I'll include links in the description to all the things I specifically talk about. I'll also include direct links to the research papers on this. And I think I need to do a little bit of reading this week to reacquaint myself with some of these aspects. You can see here. Transform. So this all looks relatively recent, actually. But it's another one where I'm curious about the early days of this. And what are the precursors to some of these things? Yeah, it looks pretty in-depth there. Oh dear, what have I done? Anyway, thanks once again for watching. Bye for now, and I will catch you in the next episode.